In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Happy New Year. Good evening. It's such a privilege to do Bible class, and I'm grateful to God for it. As usual, it's Wednesday, and having invoked the Holy Spirit, we are now ready for the Bible class. Today, we shall study chapter 21 from the Gospel of Matthew. Jesus comes to Jerusalem as King. As they approached Jerusalem and came to Bethphage on the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, "Go to the village ahead of you, and at once you will find a donkey tied there with a colt by her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, say that the Lord needs them, and he will send them right away." Jesus has now come to Jerusalem. This is going to be the last week. This is Palm Sunday for us now, today. No? These are the final days of Jesus. And he's come to Jerusalem knowing all along that these will be his last days. But there was another thing that had happened. Jesus, if you remember, had come through Bethany. Before coming to Jerusalem, he had been to the house of Lazarus. So you know why? Lazarus was dead. And there he had raised Lazarus from the dead. So the whole of Bethany, as well as, because Bethany is not very far from Jerusalem, Bethphage and everybody in Jerusalem, most of them during the Passover had come, heard about a wondrous miracle that had been performed by Jesus of Nazareth. And now Jesus was coming into Jerusalem. Jesus knew the welcome that he was going to get in Jerusalem. So he must have prepared in advance. So he tells two of his disciples to go to the village ahead of you. And at once you'll find a donkey with a colt by her. A colt is a young donkey, a male donkey, who is possibly less than a year old. That's the meaning of a colt. So he says, "Untie them both, bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, say that the Lord needs them." This means, you know, what happens in the Gospels. The Gospels now, say in Matthew, we've got 28 chapters. Now, all the 28 chapters do not cover every moment of Jesus' life. They will not tell you those, you know, the middle parts. Jesus must have already spoken to the owner of this donkey at the outskirts of the village. He was living there. So he must have told him in advance, "I'll need your donkey." And so he says, if anyone says anything to you, say that the Lord needs them, and he will send them right away. Now, the welcome that Jesus would get was the welcome that was actually given to one of Judas Maccabeus' brother, Simon. You know, when he had entered after conquering, you know, he had conquered the territory against the Syrians, he was given a warm welcome into Jerusalem. And add to that, it was the Passover. You know that every adult in the radius of 20 miles of Jerusalem, every adult had to come for the Passover, compulsorily. And not only these people would come, but people from far and wide, from the territories as far as Galilee. Forget Galilee, they come all the way from Africa, North Africa. That's Tunisia, Libya, you know, Carthage, we call them. Now, they used to come from all that, all the place, you know, all the Jews would gather at Jerusalem for the worship, you know, and the celebration of the Passover. In commemoration of, you remember, you know what, the Exodus, when the Jews actually fled from Egypt, led by Moses. He knew that he would get a welcome that was fit for a king. But why did he choose a donkey? You know, a king who came in peace, you know, who had conquered and was coming in peace to a town, would come on a donkey. But if the king was coming from victory, from the wars, he would come on a horse. That's what they say. I'll read further from verse 4. "This took place to fulfill what was spoken through the prophet. Say to daughter Zion, see, your king comes to you, gentle and riding on a donkey, and on a colt, the foal of a donkey." The disciples went and did as Jesus had instructed them. They brought the donkey and the colt and placed their cloaks on them for Jesus to sit on. A very large crowd spread their cloaks on the road, while others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. Let's try to find out who this prophet was. The first verse 4 says, this took place to fulfill what was spoken through the prophet. That prophet, if you see the subscript there, A, is this saying comes from the book of Zechariah, chapter 9, verse 9. And you can read this, yeah? So, as usual, Matthew is quoting from the Old Testament because his target audience, or the people who are going to read his gospel, are mostly Jews. So he keeps on quoting from the Old Testament because he's aware that these guys, the people who read, they also know the Old Testament. But, you know, for many, many years, as I grew up, I was always wondering, did Jesus really sit on two donkeys, sat on the mother as well as the colt? It bothered me for a long time. And as I said, unless you read all the four Gospels, you're not going to get a hang of it. So, and also you have to read Zechariah. Now, because Matthew is quoting Zechariah, and he's trying to fit in the narrative as per what Zechariah said. Now, the question is, did Jesus actually sit on two donkeys? We will see. We'll see. In the book of Mark, chapter 11, the same incident. Matthew has written, he tells his two disciples, go to the village ahead of you, and just as you enter it, you will find a colt tied there, which no one has ever ridden. Untie it and bring it here. So how many donkeys? One donkey. Let's read Luke, chapter 19, verse 30. Go to the village ahead of you, and as you enter it, you will find a colt tied there, which no one has ever ridden. Untie it and bring it here. Again, how many donkeys? One. And what is that? It's a colt, a young donkey, whom nobody has ever ridden. Because, you know, a colt who has never been ridden would not be afraid of the crowds. Then let's look at the book of John, the Gospel of John, the fourth Gospel. John just writes a simple one line. Chapter 12, verse 14. Jesus found a young donkey and sat on it. That's it, period. But look at what Matthew writes. This took place to fulfill what was spoken through the prophet. Say to daughter Zion, see your king comes to you gentle and riding on a donkey. And on a colt, the foal of a donkey. The disciples went and did as Jesus had instructed them. So they brought the donkeys, two donkeys. Yeah. And for years, people were actually, you know, wondering as to what is this? Matthew is writing like this. How can Jesus sit on two donkeys at the same time? I just want to tell you this, you know, even if Matthew was right, I just want to tell you, you know, it doesn't mean that Jesus sat on both of them at the same time. He could have sat on one and then the other. You know, that is possible. But let us go further. Let's go to verse 6 and 7. The disciples went and did as Jesus had instructed them. They brought the donkey and the colt and placed their cloaks on them for Jesus to sit on. When you read this carefully, they placed their cloaks on them for Jesus to sit on. To sit on what? On the donkey, both the donkeys or the cloaks? It is the cloaks that is last mentioned. Yeah? Immediately preceding the fact that they made Jesus sit on them, it's the cloaks, it's not the donkeys. So they made Jesus sit on the cloaks. They put cloaks on both the donkeys. Okay? So, the point is that Jesus sat on one donkey. And they had laid the cloaks on both the donkeys and Jesus sat on the cloaks. Okay? Now let's come to the point whether Jesus' triumphant entry was attended by two donkeys or one donkey. The problem comes in, you know, when you read verse 7, you know straight that Jesus sat, it doesn't say that Jesus sat on both the donkeys. But the problem comes in the preceding verse. You see verse 5, which I have purposely put in orange. See that your king comes to you gentle and riding on a donkey and on a colt, the foal of a donkey. And if you read the book of Zechariah, chapter 9, verse 9, that word and is missing. Matthew has put that and over here. We don't know why. We call this parallelism. In the Jewish way, they used to repeat a sentence twice. Slight modification, not grammatical modification, but slight modification. The same thing said twice for emphasis. So what Matthew has done, he was putting it as a parallelism, but unfortunately he put a conjunction there, and, the word and. So when a person is reading verse 4, verse 5, he thinks that Jesus sat on the donkey as well as on the colt, which is not true. And as I said, the other three gospel writers have said Jesus sat only on a young donkey, which is a colt. I hope that settles the problem. Because many people ask this question, you know, whether he sat on, if you go to the internet, you'll see all this. Did Jesus sit on two donkeys? How can he sit on two donkeys at the same time? They're volatile creatures though. And there's another thing I want to tell you, you know, regarding see donkey. You know, as I told you that we must go to Palestine, you know, to understand Jesus' sayings. We must actually go to Palestine. We must understand the customs of the Jews. We must understand the customs of the Jews 2000 years ago, when the world was not so modernized. Unless we do that, we will not understand this. You know, I got an inkling of this years ago, about, I think 15 years ago, when I was invited to speak at a Legion of Mary meeting. Seated next to me was a Maharashtrian neo-convert. And they were reading this passage. Jesus' triumphant entry into Jerusalem. And as the reading went on, this lady, you know, the Marathi lady, she heard it. And when the time came to share, you know, what they felt, she didn't have the wherewithal or the courage to ask this question. So she whispered to me in Marathi, "Pan Yeshula gadvavar basavla? Yeshula gadvavar ka basavla? So why did they make Jesus sit on a donkey?" She was right with a consternation, because she is from Maharashtra, India, in the current generation, where the villagers, when they want to punish an errant villager, they will make that culprit sit on a donkey and they will ridicule him. So she was rightly concerned about Jesus sitting on the donkey and everybody laying their cloaks. It was rather puzzling for her, because she didn't know that in Jerusalem, the donkey was a mode of conveyance. To move from one place to another, you needed a donkey, because the terrain was rather, you know, uneven. It was rocky at many places. So a donkey was a very good means of conveyance or commute. She also didn't know that there was no stigma attached to a person sitting on a donkey. She also didn't know that a king coming in peace would ride a donkey. See, what happens to the culture? You have to also understand the culture. Unless you understand the culture, you will not understand the Bible. You will have to understand the culture of the Jews. If you take your culture and, you know, sort of superimpose it on the reading that you are doing, then you will be going all awry. You will be going astray, you know, from the actual meaning. Yeah. So you must go to Palestine, and that too 2000 years ago. And you must remember the culture and the customs of the Jews 2000 years ago. Unless you do that, you will not understand the word of God. Yeah. So let's go next. The crowds that went ahead of him when Jesus was entering Jerusalem on the donkey. The crowds that went ahead of him and those that followed shouted, "Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest heaven." When Jesus entered Jerusalem, the whole city was stirred and asked, "Who is this?" The crowd answered, "This is Jesus, the prophet from Nazareth in Galilee." Now let me remind you, as I explain this passage to you, there are some very interesting things that I think we need to look at. I already told you, people were in awe of the Lazarus miracle. When he came into Jerusalem, his reputation preceded him. They had known that this man is a man of miracles, and he has healed so many for the last 3 years. He's been a rage all over Palestine. So the crowds, when they saw him, they started following him and shouting, "Hosanna to the Son of David." You know the real meaning of Hosanna. Today we say Hosanna means praise. You know, it's a thing of praise. It's an exclamation of praise. No. Hosanna did not mean praise at that time. Hosanna means save. Save us. O Messiah, save us. The Son of David is the Messiah. So Hosanna to the Messiah. Save us, O Messiah. Save us, O Messiah. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, because the Messiah would come in the name of the Lord. So save us. Hosanna means save. But the very fact that they were exclaiming to Jesus, that means they were giving the highest praise that he was the Messiah. So slowly Hosanna, the term Hosanna, which is in Hebrew means save, slowly turned from a plea of saving to an exclamation of praise. So today, even at Mass, when we sing Holy, Holy, you know, Hosanna in the highest, no? We say that we are giving you the highest praise. So the meaning of the word has slowly mutated from the meaning of save to an exclamation of praise. I hope you understand this. And blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord is taken from Psalm 118, verses 25 and 26. So when Jesus entered Jerusalem, the whole city was stirred. And who is this? Because the Passover. You know, during the Passover, about 2.5 million people would be around there. How do we know? Because according to Josephus Flavius' book, 250,000 lambs would be sacrificed during the Passover. And if you took the regulation that 10 people for one lamb, it meant that 2.5 million people at that time were during the Passover. They would come from all over the world. The diasporic Jews who had settled far and wide into foreign land would come. So let's go next. Jesus at the temple. So if he comes to Jerusalem, he has to go up to the temple. I'll read from verse 12. Jesus entered the temple courts and drove out all who were buying and selling there. He overturned the tables of the money changers and the benches of those selling doves. It is written, he said to them, my house will be called a house of prayer, but you are making a den of robbers. My house will be called a house of prayer comes from Isaiah chapter 56 verse 7. But you are making it a den of robbers comes from Jeremiah chapter 7 verse 11. I want to tell you something very interesting about this. I think you already know why Jesus did this. Those of you who have not seen our previous videos, I just want to tell you in brief. To get forgiveness of your sins, you know, you had to sacrifice doves. And during the Passover, you had to sacrifice a lamb, yeah, because you were commemorating the Passover of the Exodus. You know, the temple was made up of the inner sanctum, you know, which is the Holy of Holies, where there was a big curtain also. Then outside that was the court of priests, where the altar was there for sacrificing. Outside that, again, in the larger area, covering this was the court of the Israelites, where only men, Israeli men, Jewish men were allowed. And outside that was the court of women. And there was a small little, I have explained all this in the, you can listen, see our videos, the temples of Jerusalem. You'll see the maps and you'll see the drawings and the models. It explains very beautifully. And outside this court of women was the court of Gentiles. It was a huge courtyard where all foreigners, non-Jews could come. At the gate, you know, there was an inscription. Anybody going inside who's not a Jew will be put to death. So if you entered the court of women, you know, and you to go to the court of Israelites, you had to go through the court of women. Yeah. So anybody enters that place, he would die. So most of the money changers and these people who are selling were also Jews and non-Jews, Gentiles, you know. What were they selling? They were selling the items for sacrifice. Also, there was another problem. People from all over the world were coming. So they needed to change money. So the money changer, what would he do? He would take the money from these people and you had to pay, you know, 2 drachmas for a dove. And if you gave him a shekel is 4 drachmas. So if you gave him a shekel, then he would charge you commission not only for changing the money into shekels, Israeli drachmas, Jewish drachmas, but he would also charge you for the remaining money if you went back to him. The money changers were making money. Add to that the high priest, you know, he owned all the property here and the shops. What he would do is he would just discourage anybody to buy any dove or lamb or anything from the market because it was very cheap. His argument was that when you go to the market, you look at the cheapest dove or the cheapest lamb. Maybe that lamb would be a lame lamb or a, you know, deformed lamb. How would you dare give God an offering that was substandard? So he said that whatever you buy, you'll have to buy from the temple. Our inspectors will be checking. But the only part was, if a lamb was available for say 10 rupees in the market, the chief priests would sell it for nearly anywhere between 150 to 220 rupees. 15 times to 22 times more. It was a black market in operation. And as a result, what happened? The whole outer court of the temple was full of animals and animals, you know, passing stools over there. The place was dirty and full of noise and the cries of the lambs and the goats and everything and the doves, you know. It was just a dirty place. They had made it dirty. So the temple itself had become a marketplace. So it was for the benefit of the high priest that this business was taking place. It was not to worship God. So Jesus had tried to put a stop to it. At the very beginning, He had actually cleansed the temple 3 years ago. Now you will ask me, how do I know that he has cleared the temple 3 years ago? You know, because when you read the book of John, in chapter 2 itself, right at the beginning, after he performed his miracle at Cana in Galilee, Jesus came to Jerusalem for the Passover, and there he made a whip of cords, and he told them, get these out of here. Stop turning my father's house into a market. That is John chapter 2 verse 16, the second part of verse 16. This had started the authorities against Jesus. You know, from the beginning they were affected, because this was a time of business for them, the Passover. Imagine 2.5 million people buying so many lambs, so many doves. Imagine the amount of business in black market that this high priest was making. So the point is, they were very angry and indignant, because they said that this man is an upstart. How dare he clear the temple? Now, this was the third year Jesus was coming, and nothing had changed. So again, this time when he drives them out, he doesn't say, stop turning my father's house into a market. He says, it is written, he said to them, my house will be called a house of prayer. My house. But you are making a den of robbers. Now, the book of Matthew, Mark and Luke mention the cleansing of the temple in the last week of his life. Whereas the book of John mentions the clearing of the temple at the very outset of his ministry. As I told you, all the 3 years cannot be condensed into 21 chapters or 28 chapters or 16 chapters of Mark. So it is that it occurs. Actually, Jesus cleared the temple twice, not once. I'm sure many of you will be surprised knowing this. Yeah. And so when Jesus had started his ministry by clearing the temple, they must have thought, hamara dhande ka time hai. And we are going to suffer losses in crores of rupees. Now, this man is responsible for it. But in the beginning, they didn't do anything to him, because they were just stunned by this upstart, you know. They said, who is this guy who is coming and doing this? And on this day, in the book of Matthew, they cannot do anything to Jesus, because everybody was with Jesus. If they had touched Jesus, the whole crowd would have gone against the high priest and the chief priest. So they kept quiet, you know. But they were waiting for their opportunity. I'll read from verse 14. The blind and the lame came to him at the temple, and he healed them. But when the chief priests and the teachers of the law saw the wonderful things he did, and the children shouting in the temple courts, Hosanna to the Son of David, they were indignant, angry. Do you hear what these children are saying? They asked him. Yes, replied Jesus. Have you never read, from the lips of children and infants, you, Lord, have called forth your praise? And he left them and went out of the city to Bethany, where he spent the night. See, Jesus, they had come because they knew he was performing miracles. So all the blind and the lame came to him at the temple, and he healed them. But what do the high priests, the chief priests and the teachers of the law see? Do they see all these miracles that he has done? No. They are only noticed that the children shouting in the temple courts, Hosanna to the Son of David. And then the last verse that says, and he left them and went out of the city to Bethany, where he spent the night. You know where he spent the night in Bethany? In Lazarus' house. That's where he used to go. Jesus condemns a fig tree. Early in the morning, as Jesus was on his way back to the city, he was hungry. Seeing a fig tree by the road, he went up to it but found nothing on it except leaves. Then he said to it, may you never bear fruit again. Immediately the tree withered. When the disciples saw this, they were amazed. How did the fig tree wither so quickly? They asked. Jesus replied, truly I tell you, if you have faith and do not doubt, not only can you do what was done to the fig tree, but you can also say to this mountain, go throw yourself into the sea and it will be done. If you believe, you will receive whatever you ask for in prayer. When we look at this, you know, you just wonder, why did Jesus have to do that to the fig tree? You start wondering. Many people have wondered, you know, and they ask this question. But I want to tell you, the condemning of the fig tree is presented in Mark and Matthew as a miracle, in connection with the entry into Jerusalem. And in Luke, the same story is presented as a parable. The Old Testament symbol of the fig tree represents Israel. Israel is represented as a fig tree, you know that? And the cursing of the fig tree in Mark and Matthew and the parable in Luke are thus symbolically directed against the Jews, who did not accept Jesus as their Messiah. The tree is out of season, okay? Now, when Jesus sees that fig tree, he went up to it, you know why? Because it was full of leaves. Even though it was not the season for figs, it was full of leaves. And full of leaves means it was laden with figs. So Jesus goes up to it expectantly. He's hungry. He goes up to it. Finds nothing there. The fig tree is a deceiver. It promises a lot and gives nothing. In the book of Mark, you know, this fig tree incident becomes a sandwich. It starts, the narrative starts with Jesus coming to the fig tree. Yeah. Then Jesus saying it, may you never bear fruit again. And then the incident at the temple, the cleansing of the temple happens, where Jesus goes and drives out everybody. And then when he drives out everybody and comes out of the temple, then next day they see that the fig tree has withered. It's like a sandwich. Mark wrote this gospel first before Matthew could write. And Mark is trying to tell us that Jesus was alluding to the Jews, that the temple promised a lot, but when you entered it expecting to find God, you found it to be a marketplace. That's what Jesus intended to tell them. And if you read the latter part of that passage, you'll see that Jesus is telling them to have faith and telling them how to pray, that when you receive, if you believe, you will receive whatever you ask for in prayer. But some of them ask a question, you know, as to why Jesus had to curse. Was he such a negative person that he had to curse the fig tree? And he was hungry and it was not in season. And Jesus yet cursed the fig tree and the fig tree died. Remember, those who question this incident ignore one basic requirement to read the Bible. They are not going back 2000 years and they are not going in reference to context. Why am I saying this? In today's world, the environment and the ecology is a major, major concern for all of us. You know, we are at the cusp of destroying everything that nature had. No wonder we have the pandemic. 2000 years ago, the mindset was not like this. There was no paucity of trees. There was no paucity of anything. Man had not destroyed anything. This fig tree was by the road and it was not conforming to nature. So its death was imminent. We'll go next, verse 23. The authority of Jesus questioned. Jesus entered the temple courts, and while he was teaching, the chief priests and the elders of the people came to him. By what authority are you doing these things? They asked. And who gave you this authority? Jesus replied, I will also ask you one question. If you answer me, I will tell you by what authority I am doing these things. John's baptism, where did it come from? Was it from heaven or of human origin? They discussed it among themselves and said, if we say from heaven, he will ask, then why didn't you believe him? But if we say of human origin, we are afraid of the people, for they all hold that John was a prophet. So they answered Jesus, we don't know. Then he said, neither will I tell you by what authority I am doing these things. You know, after he drove all the merchants from the temple and he cleaned the temple, they were angry. They were looking at retribution. They wanted revenge. They wanted to catch Jesus. They couldn't catch Jesus for driving all these merchants away because the people were with him. That time they didn't catch him. Later on they'll come back to him. And they want to catch him. So they use a trick question, you know. They ask him, who gave you this authority? Jesus knows that they've come to trap him. So he tells them, I will also ask you a question. John's baptism. Now John was a great prophet. You know, the Jews had no prophet for 400 years before John. And when John came, the people were so happy that at last God had given them a prophet. But he was killed by Herod Antipas. You know the story. They loved John. So Jesus asked them, where did it come from, John's baptism? From heaven or from human origin? They couldn't say either because, you know, if they said it from human origin, people would have got angry. And if they had said it from God, then he's asking us why. Then why didn't you believe him? So they were trapped and they said, okay, we don't know the answer. And then Jesus said also, neither will I tell you by what authority I'm doing these things. And then Jesus told them two wonderful parables. We'll go through the parables. The parable of the two sons. What do you think? There was a man who had two sons. He went to the first and said, son, go and work today in the vineyard. I will not, he answered. But later he changed his mind and went. Then the father went to the other son and said the same thing. He answered, I will, sir. But he did not go. Which of the two did what his father wanted? The first, they answered. Jesus said to them, truly I tell you, the tax collectors and prostitutes are entering the kingdom of God ahead of you. For John came to show you the way of righteousness, and you did not believe him. But the tax collectors and the prostitutes did. And even after you saw this, you did not repent and believe him. The chief priests always would condemn the tax collectors and the prostitutes as sinners, that they would never enter heaven. Whereas they themselves were worse. They had God's name on their lips, but they never followed what God wanted them to do. They took advantage of everybody and everything. That's why Jesus told them this parable. Then he told them another wonderful parable, which is very true. The parable of the tenants. It had happened. For years and years, centuries upon centuries, the Jews had killed all the prophets that God had sent to them. So Jesus is now telling them the parable of the tenants. Listen to another parable. There was a landowner who planted a vineyard. He put a wall around it, dug a wine press in it, and built a watchtower. Then he rented the vineyard to some farmers and moved to another place. When the harvest time approached, he sent his servants to the tenants to collect his fruit. The tenants seized his servants. They beat one, killed another, and stoned a third. Then he sent other servants to them, more than the first time, and the tenants treated them the same way. Last of all, he sent his son to them. "They will respect my son," he said. But when the tenants saw the son, they said to each other, "This is the heir. Come, let's kill him and take his inheritance." So they took him and threw him out of the vineyard and killed him. Therefore, when the owner of the vineyard comes, what will he do to those tenants? "He will bring those wretches to a wretched end," they replied. "And he will rent the vineyard to other tenants who will give him his share of the crop at harvest time." Jesus said to them, "Have you never read in the scriptures? The stone the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. The Lord has done this, and it is marvelous in our eyes. Therefore, I tell you that the kingdom of God will be taken away from you and given to a people who will produce its fruits. Anyone who falls on the stone will be broken to pieces. Anyone on whom it falls will be crushed." When the chief priests and the Pharisees heard Jesus' parables, they knew he was talking about them. They looked for a way to arrest him, but they were afraid of the crowd because the people held that he was a prophet. This is the beginning of the end. With this, we will start our Palm Sunday. And Jesus' passion is going to unravel in the following chapters. So to summarize what we studied in chapter 21. First, we came to see that Jesus comes to Jerusalem as king. Then we read and studied how Jesus cleansed the temple a second time, not the first time. Then we saw how Jesus condemned a fig tree, that is Israel. Then, number 4, we saw how the chief priest questioned the authority of Jesus and tried to test him, but failed miserably. Then Jesus, countered them by telling them 2 parables, the parable of the 2 sons, and lastly, the parable of the 10. That's all, folks. That ends Matthew chapter 21. Until next Wednesday, 7 p.m., God bless and praise God. Don't forget to like, subscribe, share, and comment. Yeah. Subscription is free. You can subscribe. And if you have subscribed once, you don't need to subscribe again. Yeah. Thank you. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen.